Hello and welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After, a picture ebook. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will study the need for COVID-19 compatible architecture in the post-COVID-19 era and how we can contextualize it for Indian needs within the Sustainable Development Goals framework. In the last week's video, I had said we shall look at bamboo as construction material in this week's video, but pardon me for this error. We have already covered bamboo as construction material in our video on the 23rd and 24th of April 2021. Tonight we will look at rammed earth as a construction material. However, I must clarify and put on record that no COVID-related topics are found in the original work published in December 2014. Let us first recap what we have learnt in the previous book reading session before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Livelihoods based on agro-meteorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous tribal women, solid waste management, universal healthcare access, sustainable development goals, these are all factors to be included in the development agenda. COVID-19 has taught us that maximizing profits by unrealistic expansion of any enterprise is not only unsustainable but plain dangerous. This was especially true in the field of real estate development, where once independent houses stood with spacious rooms and a couple of toilets only, real estate development bordering on extreme avariciousness has led to construction of multi-storied edifices, often with commercial establishments built next to living spaces. This has congested water supply and sanitation and triggered unplanned fiscal growth. We are given to believe that outlandishly priced apartment blocks are the ultimate in luxury. In reality, though, what has happened is multiple sanitation systems trickling down multiple terraces has triggered compromised sanitation. Media personnel have to be trained in disaster mitigation, and media must play a constructive yet critical role in exposing lack of disaster preparedness. Given that in the post-COVID-19 era, there is a need for social distancing, workspaces and dwelling spaces need to be adapted for post-COVID-19 era. We already know that more than three persons should not sit in a single room, and each person has to sit at least 2 meters away from another. There has to be cross ventilation, fresh air and natural lighting. These factors imply that multi-storied terraced apartment buildings are completely incompatible to post-COVID-19 construction. Secondly, given that space is at a premium, the case in favor of single-story dwelling areas and workplaces planned therein are more sustainable. If the cost of a single-story dwelling and workplaces come down, then horizontal spread of urban infrastructure will help mainstream those who are economically backward and vulnerable. Multi-storied apartments drain water resources unsustainably. Single-storied dwelling areas also have fewer toilets and account for lesser consumption of fresh water resources, especially in flush tanks. COVID-19 is now airborne, said a report published on NDTV website, which is there embedded in the video, on Monday, 17th of May, 2021. The report calls for a rapid redesign of ventilation in buildings and stresses the need for circulation of fresh air inside buildings. On the 14th of May this year, 2021, the BBC report also reflected on the need for cross ventilation, emphasizing redesigning dwelling and workplaces to facilitate fresh air, natural lighting, and effective cross ventilation. Time is also ripe to rethink industrial scale economic production. It also helps to accommodate workspaces in dwelling areas, given the fact that work from home will be a permanent reality for the near future. To be able to mainstream economic development in semi-urban and rural areas, construction industry needs to adapt cost-effective means for building. Today, there are many alternate means of construction. Earthen material construction is just one school of thought. Earthen material construction is cost-effective, defers to local knowledge, skill, environment, ecology, geology, and resource management. It also almost wholly obliterates transport costs, as all resources are sourced on-site or in the vicinity of the site. Earthen material construction includes usage of materials like mud, stone, rock, bamboo, cow dung, clay, waste products like glass and plastic, discarded wood, recycled furniture, and so on. A Wikipedia article, the links of all of these online material are put up in the description box below. It defines vernacular architecture as, quote, characterized by the use of local materials and knowledge, usually without the supervision of professional architects. Vernacular architecture represents the majority of buildings and settlements created in pre-industrial societies and includes a very wide range of buildings, building traditions, and methods of construction. Vernacular architecture is described as a built environment that is based upon local needs, defined by the availability of particular materials indigenous to its particular region, and reflects local traditions and cultural practices. Traditionally, the study of vernacular architecture did not examine formally schooled architects, but instead that of the design skills and tradition of local builders, who were rarely given any attribution for the work. More recently, vernacular architecture has been examined by designers and the building industry in an effort to be more energy conscious with contemporary design and construction, part of a broader interest in sustainable design, unquote. Apart from cost efficacy, there are other benefits. It dispenses with air conditioning wholly. Rammed earth constructions keep the buildings cool in summer and warm in winter, which is why it is climate neutral. Aesthetic appeal, utilitarian value, organic nature of construction, which will bring down the cost of construction, transport of materials and of labor too, not just cost of building material. These are the other advantages. There is no need to paint the walls thereafter at all. Rammed earth walls come up with natural bands. This beautiful effect will be lost if painted. Its organic texture certainly needs cultivated taste and a particular mindset. Rammed earth construction is an old school 18th century architectural style and is found in many parts of the planet. Morocco, Northern Europe, Italy, Greece or Southeastern Europe, Canada, South America, China, Central Asia, Australia, Africa, India, Philippines, and so on. In earthen material school of construction, emphasis is laid on local material. Sandstone, lateritic rock, topsoil, stone, gravel, cow dung, rice husk, sand, bamboo, pulverized rock, clay bricks, thermal bricks, and only a small portion of cement is used in combination with any or all of the above mentioned materials to build a rather cool construction. Rammed earth, which is made up of 70% of mud or topsoil excavated on site and mixed with cow dung, water, rice husk, water, jelly, stone or pulverized gneiss, rock and cement. It is cooling in nature, inexpensive, healthier and solid. There is no fear of burglary with a rammed earth outer wall. Adobe is a construction material using mud and gravel from the site where the construction is to be made. Mud blocks are made with soil and gravel, and these mud blocks are then plastered by mud plaster in a certain proportion of mud and water. Adobe construction is porous, permitting air circulation even within walls. Clay bricks are very cost effective, and if you were to use clay bricks, you can completely avoid cement concrete and substitute it with mud plaster. It makes for a sturdy construction, no worries. Corbin wattle is another school of architecture. Here, mud is mixed with straw to give it a tensile strength. There is no need for bricks, beams, columns, etc. If you were to opt for Corbin wattle construction, one can go for multi-storied construction by plastering Corbin wattle on a stack of bamboo poles to increase floor area. That will still be far more cost-effective than cement concrete houses. Terracotta tiles for roofs and floors are another construction material used. Compressed soil-stabilized mud blocks are devoid of emissions because they are made without burning bricks. They can also dispense with RCC columns for construction. So that way there will be less of heat generated within the constructed area. There is no need for fans, ACs, coolers, etc. So you will cut down on emissions drastically. A double or three-story construction can also be made with earthen materials. Rammed earth walls are typically 15 to 18 inches thick. Bamboo pillars can be complemented by cement mounds to support the construction. Sandbags support the edifice further. Thus, a first floor can be supported. A second floor also needs planning well in advance. In case of a need for a second or third floor, perhaps for a large clan or a joint family, then the ground and first floors perhaps needs to be built with bamboo pillars and lateritic rock, dressed stone or rock. Then the second floor can be built with rammed earth and the third floor with Corbin wattle. There are many such construction materials. I will come to it. Many earthen materials can be used for construction, like I have already mentioned. Rammed earth, adobe, cob and battle, straw, lateritic rock, sandstone, mud, mud plaster, compressed mud blocks, timber, tiles, cow dung, rice husk, white shirt, thatched straw, mashrabia, bad gears, animal waste including blood in some parts of the world, skins, hides, fur, etc. have been used. Since building materials are wholly agro-meteorological, it has a distinct regional flavor, and earthen material construction are found all over the world, reflecting the geographical character of the materials used in construction. The Orang Asli have used bamboo for construction of long houses in Southeast Asia. The people of the Far East swear by bamboo in construction thanks to its lightweight and easy to reconstruct in seismically active areas like on the Pacific Rim of Asia maybe. The Arabs and the Bedouins, people of the Middle East, use animal hides for building tents. Similarly, the Mongols too use hides and canvas to build tents or their yurts, they're called yurts. The Eskimos use ice blocks as rock to construct igloos. Many African indigenous people use adobe or mortar with straw for roofing. The Australian indigenous style uses timber. The European indigenous style uses timber with cob and wattle to keep them warm inside half-timbered houses. The First Nation indigenes in North America use timber and rammed earth as well as cob and wattle for their construction. We have a lot of material online these days, but one link which gives you pictorial explanations on Wikipedia is embedded here in the video, and it'll also be put up in the description box below the video. The local environment and the construction materials it can provide govern many aspects of vernacular architecture. Therein lies the advantage to mainstream work from home. For the rural masses too, that will be inclusive economic growth, so to say. Gandhiji's immortal thoughts advocate that India's development lies in mainstreaming and uplifting her rural hinterland. Mud floors in vernacular architecture are climate friendly, pocket friendly and healthy. They are also resistant to termites if treated at the time of construction. Mud floors need to be treated with lime and laid on dried leaves before laying the foundation. So goes the traditional wisdom in the Laurie Baker School of Low-Cost Architecture and Construction. The advantages of a vernacular architecture based on earthen materials used for construction are, let's list out the advantages first. It is utilitarian. Traditional architecture utilizes the elements as part of design. Earthen material construction can be energy efficient because it augments natural light and circulation of fresh air. The cost of construction is low. Local materials means easy to maintain and is hence sustainable. Vernacular architecture defers to agro-meteorological conditions, wind direction, amount of rain, natural light and fresh air. Lighter in mass, so reconstruction is easier in case of damage. Expansion at a later stage is easier and does not call for destruction of constructed area while expanding. Construction is not time consuming. Construction can be completed relatively quickly. Earthen material can be sourced from the site or location, saving a lot of money on transport. Since construction material is sourced from the location, it will be sturdy and foolproof. The disadvantages of vernacular architecture include its climate neutral character means it will remain warm in winter and cool in summer, but can accentuate the ambient temperature inside four walls. Skylight ventilation windows have to be designed with accurate planning, lest rammed earth construction can get heated up, leading to cracks in the walls if there is too much of lighting and too much of heat within the plinth area. If you want to avoid cement flooring and roofs, mud floors are an option indeed. It is very healthy and complements the weather, but may be vulnerable to insect or termite attack. Treating mud flooring is essential to prevent termite infestation. Shadows can alter the ambient temperature inside the building or house, so precise planning of skylight, ventilation and windows is essential. Rammed earth construction calls for very thick walls in the range of 15 to 18 inches. This can eat up a lot of your indoor space, so planning is quintessential. Rammed earth construction calls for very thick walls. I think I mentioned this. Waterproofing the rammed earth walls will be safer. Thus, rammed earth construction or earthen material construction needs maintenance at regular periods. Waterproofing, no painted walls, etc. needs maintenance. This in the long term may be expensive. If compared to contemporary construction techniques, earthen buildings takes more time at larger scale. The implements and tools used for earthen material construction are not easy to come by. There is also a need for training. In urban areas, it is not easy to find professionals with in-depth knowledge and experience in earthen material construction. You will easily find civil engineers who preach and want to undertake construction with ready-made material like lateritic dressed stone or clay bricks. If you insist on rammed earth, they will likely suggest only one wall to be built with rammed earth. Using bamboo as pillars is unthinkable for most urban-bred architects and civil engineers. Comparatively speaking, rammed earth construction has larger built-up area because of thicker walls, which makes it less feasible in urban areas. It is an artisanal enterprise needing thumb rule wisdom, skills, and experience in using earthen material for construction. Massive industrialization and standardization in the construction field has killed regional wisdom and skill of the locals. It makes it difficult to find good artisans for earthen construction. Since profit margins are low, not many people are willing to learn this technique. But living inside rammed earth construction is heaven because of its cool interiors. In fact, traditional architecture with a central courtyard open to the sky is ideal for Indian agro-meteorological conditions. A central courtyard open to the sky is a natural receptacle for rainwater harvesting. It is the center of gravity for the structure, provides fresh air, fresh natural air and sunlight interspersed with shadows all day long, giving a heat and cold climb effect constantly. The central courtyard not only facilitates cross ventilation and circulation of fresh air, but it provides a buffer zone separating public from private areas of a household, offering plenty of space for utility areas too. Getting trained and experienced architects, skilled masonry, and experienced civil engineers to work on earthen material is almost next to impossible in India today. There are very few training institutes for those inclined to specialize in earthen material architecture. Auroville in Pondicherry is a UNESCO-designated school of architecture. It specializes and propagates rammed earth construction. Laurie Baker Center in Thiruvananthapuram specializes in low-cost construction and propagates compressed mud bricks and natural elements in designing and constructing low-cost houses. In Bangalore, India, there are Center for Green Building Materials and Technology, Center for Vernacular Architecture Trust, which propagate vernacular architecture passionately. The National Institute of Design in Ahmedabad and the Chitrakala Parishat again in Bangalore are well-known architectural design hubs. There are unrecognized artisans across the subcontinent, and we shall make an attempt to recognize them in our next episode in other construction material. Lastly, scientists have prescribed that 33% of India's landmass must have green or forest cover. If we can practice this in our tenements, 33% of our own property is covered by green cover, we will achieve a lot of SDG targets. Say if your plot of land is 30 by 40 feet, designing the plinth area within 67% of land to enable 33% green cover calls for traditional or vernacular architecture if we are to make it COVID-19 compatible. If we don't, we are not only making India a big slum, but we will deny others of quality air and good health. Indeed, it is the absence of conscientious living that has brought us such deleterious standard of living to us all. Time has come to respect nature. That is all we have for today, folks. In our next week's episode, we shall study in depth lateritic rock as construction material. We will also touch up on clay, sandstone, and mud plaster techniques in earthen construction. And we will take a look at tile making, bamboo shingles, etc., which are not only sustainable, but will also help support creation of rural livelihoods. These materials are also climate friendly and help mitigate emissions. Please do share tonight's videos in your circles. And do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and click on the bell icon. Do not forget to log in for the live interaction on Saturday, 22nd May 2021 at around 7:30 p.m. local time, Indian time that is. Don't forget to log in for the live interaction on Saturday, 22nd May at around 7:30 p.m. Indian time. I hope it will be interesting.